In Unity, each script contains a definition for a class. If we were to extend our metaphor where variables are boxes and functions are machines, then classes would be the factories that these boxes and machines are in. You may have noticed that scripts from other tutorials have the keyword class near the top. Unity automatically puts this line in the script for you when you create a new C# script. This is implicit in JavaScript, meaning that you won't see the definition, but Unity still treats the contents of this script as a class. This class shares the same name as the script it is in. This is very important, and if you change the name of one, you must change the name of the other. It is often best not to change the name of scripts or classes unless you absolutely have to, so try to name your script sensibly when you create it. The class is a container for variables and functions, and provides, amongst other things, a nice way to group things that work together. They are an organisational tool in something known as object-oriented programming, or OOP for short. The solution, and core of OOP, is to split the script up into multiple scripts, each one taking a single role. Classes should therefore be dedicated to one task. In this example, we have a script that handles a number of different tasks, so we should split it up into three shorter scripts to make it easier to manage. This script, for example, handles an inventory, movement, and shooting. Here's the script in action when attached to a cube. We can drive it around, we can shoot some small objects, and we can keep track of items in our inventory. But this is all contained within a single character script. What we should be doing is organizing this into inventory, movement, and shooting as three separate classes. So if I switch to another scene, which looks identical, then the cube has scripts which handle each of these things individually. This makes these scripts easier to manage, easier to read, and more efficient to write. Let's take a look at the use of a class. In this example, we have our inventory class, and within that we have a subclass called stuff. We create the class here, and it contains three integer variables, one for bullets, one for grenades, and one for rockets. We then create an instance of this class, known as an object, down here. We give it the data type, which is effectively the name of the class, and then we give it a name, and we say new, and again, reuse the name of the class. The brackets on the end of the name of the class imply that a constructor is being used. A constructor is a function that you can use to give default values to the variables in your class, amongst other tasks that they can perform. For example, we might set up a default constructor. Here we've given default values to each of the integer variables inside our class. This means that instead of being initialized at 0, they'll be given a default value of 1. What we can also do is write our own constructor that allows us to set parameters for those variables. So, for example, we might say public stuff, and then inside the brackets, create some parameters. Then what we might do is assign our variables to these parameters. This means that when we create an object or an instance of our class down here, we can now use the brackets to define what those default values will be. So we know that if we put in an integer, then a comma, an integer, then a comma, we'll be defining exactly what those variables within this instance of the class will be. For example, we may have 50 bullets, and you can see that MonoDevelop is helping me figure out what I'm doing by telling me as I write them. And let's say we've got 5 grenades and we've got 5 rockets. A few things to note about constructors. First off, the name of the constructor is always the name of the class. Constructors never have a return type, not even void. A class can have multiple different constructors, but only one of them gets called when an object is initialized. For example, our first constructor sets up values for these three integers. But what if we had more values? Let's put in a float for how much fuel we're carrying. Now currently, this constructor does not set up a value for that, but we could set up another constructor to do that job for us. And then if we use the parameters set up in this constructor, what we'll see is that this constructor will be used to set up our new object. So if I make one that has, for example, the bullets, and then a float for the fuel. Now that I have a separate constructor, what I can do is create an instance and use a different constructor based upon what parameters I put into that instance. So I can say new stuff, and this time I can say, for example, 50 bullets and 1.5 amount of fuel. Now, this instance of the class is going to use this constructor because the parameters match, whereas my other instance of the class will use this constructor because those parameters match. So you can do a lot of different things with constructors, and you can have multiple different constructors for the same class. So hopefully you can see how useful classes are at organizing your data when creating games. And it's recommended that you think through how your scripts are going to be laid out before you go and just write one huge class that has loads of different things in it.